Good morning, I'm Simon. We're here today to talk about resilience, innovation, entrepreneurship, that drive to create, and loving the work that you do. This drive to create, this ability to solve complex engineering problems and solutioning problems, to drive to an ultimate but different outcome or trick, not only exists in technology and software engineering, but also exists in skateboarding. Being able to place multiple elements together from previously known elements is what we deal with when we build these cloud platforms. Using previously defined elements and improving on that elements is how skaters perform tricks and create new actions within the sport. So from the ollies and the nose grinds to the way skate culture has evolved to it being more recognized within society today. In addition to serving as CTO of VMware on the IBM Cloud, I've also been a skater for many years, starting back in my early days, running away from mall cops in South Africa, to learning and spending weeks on the Sony PlayStation 1, playing the Tony Hawk skater game later on in my life. Until recently, late last year, I jumped back into the sport again, and seeing how the actual culture had evolved, the board designs had actually changed, and seeing how it was more recognized and accepted as a sport was something truly amazing that I've actually witnessed. Our first guest today is one of the most influential people in the sport of skateboarding. He has invented the majority of the modern-day skateboarding tricks that exist today, the ollie pop, the kick flip, the 360, and impossible. From the age of 14, he has defended his world title 35 times, his championship reign lasting over a decade, which is the most successful competitive reign in the history of the sport. His experience with taking risks at both physical and entrepreneurial levels is what led to successes as the co-founder of the largest skateboarding company in the 80s and the 90s. His engineering background, his love of Linux and open source, has inspired him to relate the seemingly disparate cultures of skateboarding and technical innovation together. A thinker, a risk taker, an artist, and a culture maker, I'd like to welcome to the stage the godfather of modern day skateboarding, Rodney Mullen.
Sorry, go back to that original slide, the first one of Danny dropping in. Oh, I'm sorry, go back to the original slide of Danny dropping in. Yes, please. Sorry, go back.
Skateboarding is just such a notch up from a lot of sports as far as how tough you have to be to get that good. I think that in a lot of ways, it gives you strength for the rest of your life.
In order to achieve greatness, you have to go through a lot of pain. You definitely have setbacks. But in order to achieve that success, you have to push through. You're going to have to battle injury.
Thank you.
That's my friend Danny Wang. He represents what we do in a profound way, and I'd like to share a little bit of not only what I learned from him, but from the rest of the community, because I think it transcends skateboarding. These are more my friends. All of us tend to be kind of outsiders that seek a sense of belonging, though only on our own terms. The whole community shares a common language, though each of us tries to distinguish ourselves through our individual expression of it. We're very much an open source community in the sense that the greater contribution we make through the tricks we create, the more we embed ourselves into the language others use to define themselves. This weaves us into the fabric as a whole and gives us a sense of lasting permanence. Now, if I were to list a bunch of tricks you just saw, they'd look something like this, or mostly like this. See, the way we combine movements and sub-movements imposes a kind of grammar or syntax based on the mechanics of what's going on. Nomenclature and chemistry evolve for similar reasons, and hence resemblance. So today, two kids can be texting the names of tricks back and forth, and regardless of their native tongue, they completely get every nuance of movement within the trick. They understand each other. Together, we created this. There's kind of a scholarly definition of creativity, which is to make the familiar strange. Conversely, the imagination is defined in terms of making the strange familiar. So the way that works is for each creative advance in a given domain, the imagination seeks to stretch it into an outer unknown, feeding creativity to adapt anew. The mutual tension between these reflexive couplings hurls each end forward in the march to progression. This is what we do as street skaters. Back in the early 90s, guys started to take these early flat ground tricks and project them onto the environment around them. Stairs, handrails, ledges, all of it opened up the dimensionality of what defines us. The endless ways we can combine tricks with terrain and sort of these yin-yang couplings has kept us busy for decades. We think it's quite artful. The authorities sometimes think differently. And the rotten truth, there is kind of a rogue nature to what we do. In this way and plenty of others, we have a lot in common with the hacker community. Very real way you can say what we do is we hack the environment in the sense that we use it in ways it was never anticipated, create something new in the process which we share amongst ourselves. Today there's an entire industry based upon it, but more importantly, a community of shared ethos and language. Many great skaters out there that can do whatever they see with textbook precision. This is hard to find guys who can do what's never been seen. You know, at the company, we get so many sponsor me videos where guys film just like we do. They spend whatever time it takes and send us their best in hopes that we can sponsor them and one day turn them pro. Is although they can annihilate this long list of tricks, rarely do I have a place for them on the team because they don't offer something I don't already have with the rest of the dudes already there. The only thing they lack is the one thing I can't give them, is how to express that which makes them distinctive because it comes from within. For us, individual expression always holds primacy over raw performance at these levels. This is one of the driving forces of innovation. It's actually woven or embedded within the ethos of our community. Everyone knows it through doing it, yet no one can quite teach it or explain it. So a million skaters can do that trick, but the way Brian Herman does it is singular amongst us. There's a distinctive effortlessness to everything he does, and for good reason. Just look at the lines in that frame. They match the lines in the first frame. It's a kind of perfect static equilibrium from which he draws such enormous power and makes his landing so fluid. Now, the complexity of just that trick alone, from foot placement, weight distribution, how you hold your shoulders, swing your arms, all that's interconnected, which multiplies its complexity. Yet through thousands of subtle nudges, he composed a singular set of minimized lines that imbues his skating with the kind of elegance that we all strive after. There's a great definition of virtuosity, which is to do the common in uncommon ways. Brian Herman embodies this. So together, we have this language of small, loosely joined pieces that can be shuffled and recombined in myriad ways. From the splicing together of tricks to the streamlining of the movements, we seek to simplify how those syllabic pieces fit together. Tighter it gets, better it flows, easier tricks become. Pros make it look so easy because we very literally make it easier.
If something's been done, it's so much easier to learn than if it's never been done before. If someone else has made it, then you just, in your head, it's possible you can do it. It's all convincing yourself. Every trick that I'd never done before was a matter of telling myself, you are capable of doing this, this is possible, go do it.
Tony and Rodney were both outsiders from the beginning. And for a long time, what they were doing was considered odd. They would do it, you would bring your friends to come to the park, see what Tony's doing. Hey, we're going to come out behind the building. I'll show you what Rodney's doing. And they would go look at that, and they go, oh, it's like a freak show.
It's another reason why Tony Hawk is the greatest skater ever. Together as kids, we were put on kind of an elite team called the Bones Brigade. All of us were chosen because we had certain skills, but more importantly, a common mindset. And once banded together, a new sense of normal took hold that was really anything but that. It pushed back the horizons of what was possible, and more importantly, it cracked open realms that people considered impossible. As testimony to that, one of the guys actually invented a trick called the impossible because people literally thought it was. Really soon afterwards, harder variations just kept coming. Point being, this kind of shared belief generated a synergy amongst us that took us further than we would have ever made it as individuals. How do you practice stuff that can get you killed, right? It's often said the best skaters are the best fallers, and that's pretty good evidence of it. Through a paradigm of managing failure on a sustainable basis, you develop a kind of predictive acumen. It's not that Jamie's reactions are so fast, just able to anticipate what's going wrong and act accordingly in an automatic way. This same kind of somatic awareness gives them the clarity to hold on even when it's sketchy. And you can see it. Those last few tries, he's definitely off. But he has the wherewithal to bring it down, which bridged the gap to the ultimate make. That in itself separates good skaters from great. All that matters is rolling away cleanly. There's no partial credit. So this same somatic awareness is so finely tuned that it's first of all out of tune when practice begins to wane. And you see this. Sometimes if you've been off your board for a bit, the basic motor functions stay in place remarkably well, which leads to a false sense of confidence. Next thing you know, you start getting hurt. Because you lose that finely tuned acumen of where you and your board will be at that precise moment of commitment. This leads to a cycle of injury and being off your board and re-injury. It's retired more pros than I can begin to count. So the deliberate maintenance of this subtle nuance is what keeps you on the edge of sustainable failure.
Feel like I got a lot more to give.
every trick, most every trick you've seen so far takes hours, if not days, if not longer. The vast majority of what we do is fall and get back up again. That shapes us proportionally, both as individuals and as a community. Today, most skater companies are owned or operated, at least crucial juncture, by real pros, due to have really lived a life. So what that means is by the time you're signing the dotted line, both sides understand what's expected of them. They know they have to keep paying you for sometimes month on end for no results. Sometimes you might be walking around on crutches and you're expected to go right back to what you did when you got hurt and take it even further, push into the unknown, and one day you might not come back from that. This up close and personal relationship with risk and consequence is one of the reasons we really move so fast as a community and evolve so rapidly. We understand each other. This is Jamie Thomas. He left everything, came out west, hopes of becoming a pro. Pretty soon he ended up homeless, and for the most part, largely rejected. Today, on top of his hallowed place within the community, the success of his companies have been so intense that Ernst & Young named him one of their entrepreneurs of the year. It's Danny Way. He essentially broke his neck well into his career. He couldn't heal, could barely move, and an army of doctors couldn't help him. More desperate by the day, he sought out some dude. The term witch doctor was tossed around. Doctors warned him that if this guy tugged on his neck the wrong way, it would paralyze him. Instead, Danny went for it. Got back on his board. I think he's done more to change skateboarding after his injury than even before, maybe even because of his industry. Today, he runs one of the most elite skate companies in our industry called Plan B. And this guy, Tony Hawk, on top of his unparalleled abilities as a pro and his thriving companies, his foundation has done more to give back to skateboarding than anybody else. He's built hundreds of parks around the world, and this edifies us and the future generations more than can be counted. There's no one who's given more to skateboarding than Tony Hawk. These are just the guys who have stayed within the communities. Others have taken it much further outside the community, from Academy Awards to multiple Grammys, even running one of our finest academies. Where I'm going with this is, while the basic knowledge for whatever endeavor is always attainable, it's these subtleties in teaching ourselves how to learn and handle failure that form the basis of the resilience and intuition we need to work within that framework. Furthermore, what ultimately propels and sustains you is just a love for what you're doing in the first place and a guiding respect for the ethos that binds you as a community. Anyway, it's worked for me, so my friends. I hope it can translate into something you can do. Thank you for listening to me.
So, our next guest is one of the most recognized sports action figures in the world. When Tony Hawk was 9 years old, his life was changed when his brother handed him a fiberglass Barney skateboard. By 14, he had turned pro. By 16, he was widely recognized as the best skateboarder on earth. In 1999, around the same time that he launched the Tony Hawk Pro Skater video game, which is now a billion-dollar franchise, he completed a 900. He has created the Tony Hawk brand. He has created Birdhouse Skateboarders, clothing lines, and toy lines. He has a 900 film production company, which has launched the Ride Channel on YouTube, which is the most successful skateboarding channel out there in the world today. His Tony Hawk Foundation has donated $7.4 million and created over 600 skate parks all around the world, giving back into the community. It is my pleasure to introduce skateboarding legend, Tony Hawk.
Hey everybody, how are you? Thanks for having me. Fair warning, my speech will not be as polished as Rodney's, which is a great metaphor for our styles of skating. His is much more perfected and clean and practiced, and mine is a little more loose, I guess, and unpredictable. So anyway, I'm trying to relate what I do to what you guys do, which I don't think is a far stretch, but I started skateboarding at a very young age. And when I started doing it, it was just on the way out of being cool, which I didn't understand or realize, and luckily didn't really accept. So when I first started skating, I was doing it with some friends in the neighborhood, and it seemed kind of cool, like a toy, almost, I mean, it was likened to a hula hoop at the time. It was very much a fad. And I got invited to go to the skate park not long after. And when I went to the skate park and I literally saw people flying out of swimming pools, that was it. That was my moment. I said, I want to do that. When I first started skating, I didn't have any epiphany. I was just doing it because my friends were doing it and my older brother was into it. But literally when I saw these people doing acrobatics in the air, I thought, I want to do that, whatever it takes. And not long after, I got my first concussion, knocked my front teeth out, and woke up in the ambulance. And my first thought was not, what have I done? I'll never do that again. My first thought was, well, I should position my feet better when I do rock and rolls in that bowl. And I learned from that mistake. And I think that was the moment where I thought, this is what I really want to do going forward. I was 10 years old. I didn't think I was choosing a career. It most certainly wasn't a way to make a living at it. And I just loved it. It became my passion. And I spent every free moment I could when I could get rides at the skate park, trying to learn new tricks. There was a skater back then, Eddie Alguera, who was known for, he was actually known as the robot because he was doing all these tricks and everyone else was all about their style and how they looked and their slash. And I was looking at him because I was a scrawny kid. I didn't have the bulk to propel me into the air, but I knew that maybe I could do these tricks and maneuvering my board and things. And at some point I learned how to actually reach down, grab my board, turn it, you know, do a little jump, turn it in the air. And suddenly I realized that it was the thing that I had done had never been done before. I was 11 years old. I didn't think I was pioneering new moves. I was just trying to figure out new ways to maneuver my skateboard because I didn't have the strength to get up way above the lip. And that, I think more than anything gave me the reason to keep going, because suddenly I realized that skateboarding was this empty canvas. It was something that you could just create anything you wanted and be accepted in the world, in the community, but in your own style. And I was literally making up tricks all of a sudden. Not that anyone really cared. In fact, the older generation thought I was a joke. And that was hard for me, mostly because I was already marked as an outcast because skateboarding wasn't cool. So in the world of my school, for instance, I had to hide my skateboard just so people weren't making fun of me. We now call this bullying, but back then you were just getting picked on. And so I would go to, and I'd go to the skate park, and then I was shunned at the skate park because I was doing these little, what they called circus tricks. And I was just like, I'm trying to do this because it set me apart and it's different. And the community that is doing it for the most part weren't accepting the way I was doing it. And I can tell you very much that Rodney was in the same boat. The stuff he was doing, just no one understood it. His was much more groundbreaking as far as I'm concerned. But no one really accepted that he was pioneering a whole new movement. And so I just kept doing it. I found some friends that were like-minded, that they thought of doing the same types of tricks. That, you know, we were all scrawny, so that was our focus. And at some point, I started getting more strength, more confidence. And like Rodney said, just practicing, getting little nuances of these tricks. And suddenly I was doing them above the lip. And that is when people started taking note, and that's when I started getting more recognition, more validation, sponsors, things like that, and I started winning events. And that's when the sort of older generation and the haters had to shut up. It very much set me up for it actually was good training for the age of haters, and I'll explain that later. But I had my first taste of it then, and I was thankful that I did so. So through the years, I kept skating, I kept learning these tricks, and then suddenly I was winning these events, and it was weird because this all sounds fantastical, and it's you know, it wasn't something that was, what can I say? It wasn't some glorious life. I was still an outcast at school. I was, the skate competitions were $100 for first place, $75 for second, and $50 for third. You got to do that maybe once a month, if that. So I was saving up for a moped. That was the goal. I didn't think I was choosing a career. I you know, in skateboarding, when you reach an age of responsibility at that time, that's when you had to find a job. No one was living at large. I didn't expect to. I didn't want to. I just loved doing it. I think that was it. I love the innovation of skating. I love that it set us apart. I love the culture involved, the music, the looks. Everything was so exciting to me and kind of scary to the mainstream audience. But that didn't really bother me because I grew up at the skate park and, you know, listening to punk rock through the speakers, and that was my tribe. So fast forward to later on, about high school, I was making really good money. I bought a house when I was still a senior in high school. Try being motivated to go to school in your senior year when you live on your own with three roommates. Let's just say that I got marked down in my first class only because I was late every day. Not because I wasn't doing the work, but because I just showed up late, disheveled. So as I was graduating high school, I realized that I was actually making more money than my teachers. And they were all trying to tell me which college I should be going to. And I realized, like, I already have a job and a career and a house. I'm going to follow this path, which was amazing, but at the same time, very risky. And not long after, the bottom basically fell out of skateboarding. I was in my early 20s. I had two mortgages. I had a son on the way. And all of a sudden, my income was dropping by half every month. And it was really challenging. But I think that it taught me how much I truly love skateboarding, because I was never going to quit. And I kept doing it. I decided to start a skateboard company, which seems like the most ridiculous idea, because everything was falling apart. Anyone that was a pro skater back then was not making a living at it. They had to go find jobs. But it allowed me to remain in the industry, and I believed, and along with my partner, my business partner, that skateboarding was cyclical and it was gonna come back around. We didn't know how big or when, but we were betting on establishing ourselves as a company at a time when it was at its lowest in popularity, because at that time, we could make a lot of noise and become considered one of the best brands. And the skate magazines were desperate for advertising, so we got the back cover of the skate magazine for a few hundred dollars. And that really set us up, because we had one of the best teams. We had a unique aesthetic to our brand. And we just hunkered down. And I basically... basically took a second mortgage out on one house, sold that for what I owed on it, moved into the first place it very modestly, basically ate Taco, this is all, I've talked about this, but it's all true, basically ate Taco Bell and Top Ramen for a good 2 years, if more, if not more, and just made the company work. And we were in the dredges, you know, we were doing everything. I was calling shops, I was doing marketing, I was laying out the ads. I wasn't very good at it, but I was doing it. I was making all the videos. And I look back on it, it seems like a struggle back then, but it was a blast. And learning all these new skills and supporting a team that really believed in us. You know, they threw everything away. A couple of them actually had successful sponsors that were still doing pretty well, and they left them to come to my company because they believed in my vision. So that in itself was the validation I needed. And as it started to grow, we went through about 3 or 4 years of debating on whether we should just throw in the towel. It was very tricky. We kept taking pay cuts. We were trying to do everything we could. We would take our delivery van and go on tour. And when I say go on tour, that means to beg a shop to give us gas money and maybe take us out to food. And then give us a couple hundred dollars for one hotel room for five dudes. and skate in their parking lot. Whatever they had available to skate, that's what we were doing. And that's how we promoted our brand, basically. So we were on the road for 5 weeks, skating almost every single day on super junky scrap wood in shopping center parking lots, promoting our brand. But it was a blast, and we loved it. Not long after that, the X Games came into play, and it was this weird experiment of a mishmash of what they called extreme sports. And so we were lumped in with rock climbers and bungee jumpers and sky surfers, and everything was extreme, and it was presented, you know, very much exploited in a way that we weren't used to. But we agreed to participate because we thought that skateboarding was already refined, was already established as far as we were concerned, and we thought that our skills would shine through and rise above the noise, because a lot of the stuff was just kind of experimental and silly. It did. It took a while, but that definitely happened. So as that progressed, the X Games got a little more refined. They started dropping the silly sports away. I apologize to anyone who might be sky surfing these days, or bungee jumping as a sport. They sort of dropped those auxiliary sports. They focused on the ones that were getting the most hype, which were skateboarding, BMX, and eventually motocross. And things started to finally turn around at Birdhouse. Birdhouse is my skate company. We were actually making a profit and realized that even though this programming was kind of silly, our vibe was shining through, and people were starting to really notice and actually support our products. Then I have to fast forward this story, but basically I got the chance to work on a video game. I weighed some various options and went with Activision because they already had an engine. And when I went to their offices to talk to them, they presented me with, basically, they had worked on this game called Apocalypse, starring Bruce Willis. The game was a flop, but they believed in the engine that they built for the game, the motion. And so they presented me with a PlayStation controller of Bruce Willis as a character with a gun strapped to his back on a skateboard going through this dystopian wasteland. This is not a joke. And I could control him and make him do kickflips and ollies and things like that. And as ridiculous as that sounds, I knew that there was something there. I felt like this was intuitive controls. This could be something really special with my resources, with my expertise, with my influence. And I signed on right there. And I had already been talking to a couple other developers, but this just felt right. And I'll never forget, as we were ramping up to the release, I started sharing it with other skaters, other prominent skaters, including Rodney, and they just started calling it the game. I said, "Have you played the game? Do you know?" And I knew then that at the very least, I had a game that skateboarders would appreciate, and that was really the goal. I wanted a game to be out there that skaters were proud of and that they wanted to play. Skateboarding wasn't popular enough really to be a genre of video games or something that other people that are playing Madden would even be interested in, but I was going to be proud of the fact that skaters liked it, and we kept it authentic with the tricks, with the locations, with the skaters. But I knew there was something special happening when, just upon the release, Activision offered me a buyout of future royalties for $500,000. No one had even spoken the words $500,000 to me in my lifetime, or even hundreds of thousands of dollars. And it gave me a great pause, obviously, but I was doing pretty well with other sponsorships, with competitions. I had just bought a new house and raising a family, and I said, "No, I think I'm going to take a chance with what's going on." And they were already talking about a sequel before the first one came out. It was by far the best financial decision I've ever made in my life. As I'm sure many of you know, the games went gangbusters. They sold over $1 billion. And obviously, I made a lot of money. I made more money than I ever dreamed in any industry. And as that was all happening, that became my second wave of haters. Suddenly I was the sellout. I was, you know, they call me Bagel Boy because I had an endorsement with Bagel Bites, which I still eat, by the way. It's not a joke. And McDonald's, which I still eat too. And then I was the poster boy for selling out skateboarding, for exploiting it for all the worst reasons. And my argument to that was, these products I believe in, I do truly participate or consume. And if you had offered me a McDonald's sponsorship when I was 14 years old riding my skateboard, I was like, hell yes. I would have done it for free food. And so then I just had to realize I got to believe in myself and do what I really believe is right. And eventually, the video game was huge. It opened up new opportunities for me and new ways to promote skateboarding. I stopped competing. I started a tour. I started a foundation to help build public skate parks in low-income areas. And as he said, we have been going for 16 years now. We've helped to develop over 700 skate park projects across the world. And that's the work that I'm most proud of. So I think what I've learned through that and through promoting skateboarding, obviously promoting myself as well, and use of social media, I think that's been a really interesting facet, and my third wave of haters. If you really want to get if you want to get a pulse on how people are feeling about you, just go out and check out your name on social media. It gets rough out there. But at the same time, I've learned that it's a great connection to your fan base. It gives you very raw, very honest feedback immediately, and it's been the greatest focus group that I've had. And I try to make it interesting. At least, you know, it's not like, oh, I'm hungry. Here's my coffee. Yay! I'm trying to keep it more entertaining and stuff that I experienced that I think, you know, the kind of things I get to do like this. Like, I never thought that I would be able to be at a conference on stage just talking about skateboarding. I never thought that people would ever pay me to skateboard, let alone pay me to talk about skateboarding. But it's a blast. And so I try to share that, all these sort of absurd scenarios. And I'm sure that some of you have seen my encounters with TSA agents and airport recognition. That stuff seems to be going viral these days. And it's all true. Follow me for a day and you'll see how it goes. But it's been a blast. For events like this, you know, I'm thankful to be able to share my story and hopefully to connect it to what you do in terms of following your passion, staying true to your brand, being authentic, and how to have sort of a group evolution of products and tricks. What Rodney was talking about, you know, all these tricks that we've been doing, we're doing it on the backs of giants, and in a lot of ways, the new generation are doing it mostly on the backs of Rodney. But they've learned these techniques that he created. They've learned to tweak them and to add to them. And we love that collective evolution of it. It's not something that we're trying to be proprietary, that we're trying to hold on dear to ourselves or patent somehow. We want that to be the shared evolution. We love that skateboarding continues to evolve like that. And I think that attitude could resonate across a lot of different industries. In fact, you know, people, they like to get a technology and hold it dear to themselves, and if they just shared it with everyone else, then we'd be evolving a lot better and a lot faster. I hope something that I've said, you can relate to what you guys are doing here, and I just appreciate IBM and VMworld for having me, and this has been a blast, so thank you very much.
Mark's back here. We'll just swap out for that. Okay. I'll turn that one on. Use the handle because it's. You can leave that one.
So thank you, Tony. So wherever, guys. So what we wanted to do was ask a couple of questions, both to Rodney and Tony. So in some of your TED Talks, you've mentioned the art of falling and the perseverance. When, particularly as we're doing cloud migrations, we're doing this whole shift to the cloud where organizations are moving their legacy architecture, moving. The whole migration is a trial and error process where trial, fail, get up, try again. It's very much a similar process on how we do migrations, how we perfect the migrations, and ultimately get there. When we were actually talking backstage and that, and you were explaining something, the similarities between you and the art of falling and how we compose these systems and how we try and go again and again really struck me. So if you could talk a bit more about the art of falling and what you actually meant by that and some of the concepts around it.
Thank you. There's someone I respect, I don't know, John Seeley Brown, JSB, lead scientist at Xerox PARC. He's like, said something along the lines of, if I hear one more talk about just failure, because it's driving me nuts. Yeah. Because you can't just go out there willy-nilly, you have to fail to succeed. Skateboarding is so good where there is an art to it, because if you do take a wrong step in the wrong way, that can end you. At that time, you don't come back from stuff. Even physically, if you're okay, you don't come back mentally very well. And you play in defensive positions in a sense, like there's lots of ways a good failure can wreck the rest of your career. And so part of what we do is, how do you minimize what will happen to you? So like, okay, I can take that, I can get out of it, I know I'll get hurt, but I can take that in a certain way and still go on. Whatever you do, don't fall that way because that will end you. So that's part of the art of it. Okay. And again, that sort of somatic awareness or doing it again and again, it is you step up where more and more and more, put it this way, if you learn a basic trick and then take it to something sketchy, all goes out the window and you do everything you shouldn't have done and you slam, right? So it's all about fear inoculation in our sense of taking gradual steps up until you basically, you've been inured, like you build a tolerance for it. And so that's one of the things for us. There is an art to it. It takes time.
Yes. Yeah. No, thank you. So, Tony, we heard earlier on in the general session with VMware, and we had Malala Yousafzai at the general session. There's been a lot of action about tech giving back into the community. With an IBM, we've got this Call for Code program, which is basically bringing hackathons around the world where they're trying to create solutions for disaster preparedness. When we looked at your foundation and giving back, putting the skate parks in different places in the world, what effect has that had on the community with Skatistan and what have you seen? How has that engendered the community and the building of the actual?
Well, I think that for one, it gives them a sense of validation and that they're being taken care of and that they have a place to go to share ideas. They're not getting kicked out. I think that the bottom line is the reason that we even created the foundation was because I saw skateboarding getting more and more popular with a serious lack of facilities. And you see kids in more disenfranchised areas that found skateboarding, that found something they really love and were largely told that they can't do it. Can't do it here, you're not allowed to be here, don't be on the street. And I knew what skateboarding provided me as a kid, a sense of self-confidence, a sense of individuality, and something that I couldn't find in any other sport or activity. And I wanted to have these kids be able to have that same confidence, that same sense of self, but a place to do it, and a place where they're taken care of. And I didn't really know, anything about nonprofits at the time, or how we went about it, but we knew that we could be a resource to get it done, and we literally have a step-by-step guide to getting a skate park in your area. But for the most part, we empower the communities that want to help themselves. We don't just say, this city needs a park, it has a lot of low-income areas, and here you are, and we get all the accolades. We really want to help the communities that have been trying to do it themselves by holding fundraisers, by going to city council meetings, and then they feel a sense of ownership with it, and we just give them the resources and walk away.
Okay. Thank you. So if you look at the skate culture today, particularly when I came back in the end of last year and how different it was, and it really was, as you said, it was looked down upon, it was frowned down upon. traveling around with a board these days, I still see people look at you differently. You do see people take a step back. So you can see the culture.
Well, they look at you differently when you're our age.
True. But people still, you see still people taking a step back. But I've seen it's so much more widely accepted than it was when we were kids. It really was. You were seen, as you said, it was a toy. It was seen as a hula hoop. I mean, living through that and being a part of that, that must be so humbling and enthralling as you go forward with this, because that's got a lot of down to you two guys. So I'm interested to see your opinion, not where it's actually going to evolve, but where do you see this actually going?
Where is it going? Well, it'll be in the Olympics in Tokyo 2020, and a lot of people think that that's as far as, you know, that's the top of the line. For as far as I'm concerned, skateboarding needs the cool factor. The Olympics need the cool factor of skateboarding more than skateboarding needs the validation of the Olympics. I mean, I believe that. Like, there are so many sports in the Olympics that are so wildly unpopular. And somehow, because they're in the Olympics, then they're validated, and that's the career. But it is exciting to think of the international awareness that will happen through that. And Rodney and I have actually had pretty deep discussions about this, because they're not going to reinvent the wheel. Yeah. Skateboarding was already a competition sport. It's not selling out. It's not sanitizing what we do. It'll just be seen by more people.
Oh, very cool. Looking at the different periods of ride style evolution, as you've seen it through the career, and that influencing that ride style evolution, are you seeing some of the pushback in the skating community? So if you look at the youngsters coming through the sport, taking what you guys have done as a base and creating their new tricks, do they get as pushback that you did as young kids? Because you mentioned, both of you, you were considered outsiders because you were skaters, but within the skate community, you were also considered outsiders yourself, because you were evolving and innovating and doing things nobody had ever done before. Do you see some of the same pushback from some of the other young up-and-comers? Do they go through the same these days?
Yeah, there's two things I can say in a layered way, and one that might be more easier to transpose is within our company, when we started World Industries, at that time there was, if you remember the Alva ad with all those dudes in leather jackets, it's like, we're tough guys, you know? Like, we're not tough guys, we just skate. And everything for the company at the time, how you basically had to have a skeleton, and that was understandable, but it was skeletons, right? Darkness. And we rebelled with cartoon graphics. Cute little goofy things that still had the spirit, mischief. Yeah. But the point was, is rebelling against a sort of rebellious community. There is a component where people have a conformist way about them. Oh, we're rebellious. But they're not at all, it's just a role. And so how do you rebel within a rebellious culture to be true to the culture in a way that others recognize? And that was what exploded, like our company just launched because of that. Because I think everyone got that sense of, it's like a kit you get to look tough or something. And we rebelled against that in a way that was true to the ethos of rebellion. And there's some sort of beauty in that, you know? So, what was the question again?
We'll move on. So, your stories have similarities. Both of you started very young. You've grown up together in the sport. You've defined the sport on different coasts. Yeah, I mean, Rodney, you on the east, you on the west coast. You have a great deep respect for one another. That's obvious. You have a great deep relationship for each other. I mean, do you guys collaborate beyond and outside of things? Do you guys still collaborate together? Do you come up with ideas together and, you know, work together moving forwards? How do you?
We try. Our lives don't intersect as much as you'd think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I'm skating the big ramps. Mm-hmm. Rodney is skating flat concrete.
Yeah, concrete, so.
In the middle of the night with no one watching. I'm not kidding. So yeah, our lives, like our skate lives, don't intersect very much. And but every once in a while, we'll end up, you know, in the same place, same event, and things like that. I think the last true collaboration that we had was doing video games, right?
Yeah.
Cool.
Rodney, we were both at a crossroads in our careers where we weren't competing anymore, but we were trying to keep skating. We were both being creative and hopefully innovative at the time, but we were both unsure of what to do because no one had really been down that road, especially after a competition, because that wasn't a career option necessarily at the time. I had just started the video game series, so I was pretty excited about that and the opportunities it was bringing. Rodney was more in, I don't want to speak for him, but I think he was in more of a very uncertain time. Mm-hmm. And I said, why don't you be a character in the video game? Yeah. And that was it. And I feel like in a lot of ways, when people saw Rodney, because suddenly the video game brought a new audience to skateboarding and a new appreciation for it.
Yep.
And then when Rodney was included, they saw the level of what he was doing, and that was it. People were like, fuck Tony Hawk, Rodney Mullen.
Right.
And they still say that.
Being in that game changed my life. Like, I had not gone on tour since, so last year tour, game comes out, new tour, and it was night and day. I couldn't believe how people responded because of the game. That literally changed my life.
It validated our game series, that's for sure.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, guys, we're wrapping things up. Thank you so much for having been here today, for having spent the time today. Rodney and Tony will be visiting the IBM booth between 4 to 5, where everybody has a chance to win a free pay ticket to the X Games. So it's when they're going to the X Games. And Rodney and Tony will be at the booth between 4 to 5 giving skateboard giveaways and that sort of
I'm
stuff.
Glad you said giveaways. I thought you were about to say lessons.
I think I need a couple
Rodney
of
will teach you all how to ollie impossible. By the end of the day.
Right?
Yeah, on the carpet.
And I'll teach you how to make twists. Let's go.
Yeah, that's right.
So listen, guys, thank you for everything you've done, and please keep doing what you do. Thank you.
Thanks, everybody.